chart and the card which you have before you. Just by way of a little explanation as far as the chart is concerned. I hesitate at times to use an illustration like this because many times people feel as though, oh, now this is simply the inspired thing from the Word of the Lord. Now I would simply like to emphasize once again, as I've always emphasized, every time I begin to teach or try to teach from this chart, that this is not inspired. The only thing that is accurate is your Bible. Now, this happens to be a study that we performed and were engaged in a number of years ago. And after 2 or 3 years of study, we wanted to draw up a chart that would give us a preview of prophecy. Come right on in, right? And sort of give us a bird's eye view of the prophetic picture. Come right on in. Just go right over there, right?
Sorry.
Apparently you didn't find.
No, they're supposed to be on their way. I thought they'd be here.
And so after we had studied for some time and decided to put it down in sort of a simplified manner, I had one of my students, who was Carol Todd at the time, she happens to be Mrs. Werner Peters now, she did the artwork for me. In fact, she drew, or she painted three charts for me. The first chart I gave to one of my students that was with me in the gospel team ministry a number of years ago, and he's down in Southland using it now. But the other two I have. This is a small chart that I take with me on the plane as I go from place to place in ministry, and then we have a large 6x12 chart, which is the chart that is the, this is a picture that you have, the postcard, of the large 6x12 that we have at home. Now, this is simply an illustration of that which we feel is the plan and the program of God as it unfolds chapter after chapter and book after book, beginning with the early chapters of the book of Genesis and ending, of course, with the book of Revelation. And so we have entitled this particular chart, From Time to Eternity. Now there is another chart that you would have great profit in study called Eternity to Eternity. And that particular chart will take you back into eternity past and then take you right on through time and on into eternity future. However, I felt as though just to have a brief presentation and a progress with reference to the unfolding of the plan of God, that we would simply start there in the early chapters of the book of Genesis and wend our way through the Bible to see his plan and his program unfold into eternity. Now, as far as this chart is concerned, from time to eternity, there are a number of names that you will observe on the chart, and they all have a great deal of significance as far as the prophetic program of God is concerned. However, I would like to simply, first of all, draw your attention to these two particular lines. Now, the paint is rubbing off a little here. These are supposed to be solid up to this point, and then you have the dots. But you have the two lines. You have the green line, and then you have the red line. Now, these two lines that begin here in time and end in eternity, those two lines represent for us two classifications of humanity called the Gentile and the Jew. Now, the Gentile is not so termed as such until after the call of Abraham and God establishes a new classification of humanity called the Jew. And it is with these two lines of humanity we will be dealing with throughout the scriptures and observing God's program that relates to both the Gentile and to the Jew. And you'll observe that these lines change. One goes up, one goes down. And as a result, this deals with the work of God in reference to these lines of humanity. Maybe we'll just check and see if there's someone else here.
Right in.
Come in, come in here. How are you folks? I mean, you got back from your trip already.
That's what we're having. I pulled the one.
Yeah. Picture of the chart, you folks, just in postcard form. And as we watch these two particular lines representing, the green representing the Gentile, the red representing the Jew, it's very, very interesting to see God's working with humanity in this way. And in fact, his entire program is zeroed in on humanity. And of course, with special reference to the Jewish people. Now, you will observe these titles, the times of the Gentiles. Now, the times of the Gentiles is that period of time when the Gentile has the ascendancy or the supremacy as far as the political world is concerned. The Gentile is in the place of ascendancy. That relates to the times of the Gentiles. And we will learn more about it, but the times of the Gentiles simply began when God chastened his Jewish people there with the Babylonian captivity and took the Jew into captivity. And beginning with Nebuchadnezzar, you will find that the scriptures teach us that the Gentile is in the place of ascendancy over the Jew in the realm of the political activities of life until the times of the Gentiles end with the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ to the earth. That is called the second advent. Now the first advent, of course, for the Lord is when he came as a babe and was born. His second advent is when he comes to the earth to bring an end to the supremacy, among many things, of the Gentile rule upon the face of the earth, and then the Jew enters back into his rightful place of ascendancy and privilege before God. Now, here are some figures. The 483 years relates to the 69 weeks of prophecy of the ninth chapter of the book of Daniel. Then, of course, 32 AD relates to the time of the death of the Lord. Now, there's a term here called the fullness of the Gentiles. The fullness of the Gentiles. Now, that is a specific reference to God's dealing with great privilege and blessing to the Jew during what is called the church age, from Pentecost until the rapture. Not until the second advent, but until the rapture. And it is at this time you will find, in, for instance, in Acts chapter 19, at the great Jerusalem council, where you have the whole issue brought up there in the apostolic days with reference to God's dealing with the Gentile in relationship to the Jew. And so you have Peter standing and giving words of testimony with reference to what God did through him at Cornelius' house in the 10th chapter of the book of Acts, where there was a Gentile saved without conforming to the Judaistic ordinances whatsoever. And then Paul and Barnabas stand up and they give testimony with reference to what God had done to and through them as they had ministered to the various Gentiles in the areas of their ministry. Then James stands up, and he takes the word of the Lord, and he gives this testimony that God is now drawing from the Gentiles a people for his namesake. Taking out from the Gentiles. And then, of course, one of the great chapters of the Bible, that relates to Gentile blessing is Romans chapter 11, where you have the great olive tree and how you have that tree representing the blessing or the full blessing that is given to the Gentile at this time. And God has set aside the Jewish people as a nation, but not turned his back upon the Jew as far as individuals are concerned. It is at this time both Jew and Gentile, both Jew and Gentile, have the privilege of having a right relationship with God by virtue of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for their sin, was buried, triumphantly raised, and of course ascended into the heavenlies. And one of the great truths with reference to both the Jew and to the Gentile is found in Acts chapter 2, with the testimony of the Apostle Peter there in the day of Pentecost, how that God had raised up Jesus and had made him both Lord and Christ. Lord, who is the head of the church in light of Colossians chapter 1, verse 18, that is head over all believers, and Christ, that is the term anointed that relates to Messiah, the wonderful promised Messiah, as we're going to see throughout the Old Testament prophecies. And then the 7 years is that great tribulation period, which is the consummation of the 70 weeks of Israel as prophesied in Daniel chapter 24. And it is at the end of the 70th week, or that the 7 years, the end of the 7 years, that you have the Lord Jesus Christ returning to earth to do away with all of this godlessness and to establish what is called the wonderful, glorious millennial reign of Christ for that thousand-year period upon the face of the earth, where the Jew then comes back to the place of blessing and the Jew receives his rightful due before God, and then they enjoy that blessing which they were deprived of because of their sin back in the Old Testament days. And then, of course, you have the consummation of time when the present heavens and the present earth simply go up in a great conflagration of fire. And one of the immediate activities after the destruction of the present heavens and the present earth, of course, the creation of the new heavens and the new earth, what is called the Great White Throne Judgment. This is a time when all wicked humanity from all ages, wicked angelic beings, are judged and are cast into what is called hell, or the Gehenna fire, to suffer eternal torment and punishment forever. And in quite contrast, you have then the great celestial city, where there's no night there, there's no need for the light of the sun, moon, or the stars, because the glory of the Lamb lightens the great celestial city. And of course, I believe that as far as the classification of both Jew and Gentile is concerned, that God not only maintains that distinction here in time, but for his own reasons, I believe he maintains it throughout all eternity. Because you will read in the book of the Revelation how that this city is a city four square and has 12 gates. And those 12 gates, their names relate to the 12 tribes of Israel, built upon the foundation of the apostles, and the apostles' names, of course, are the foundation stone. Now then, passing from these particular names, you'll notice you have illustrated on the chart a number of ranges of mountains. And these mountains have different colors to them. Now, first of all, mountains represent for us, according to the scriptural terminology, they represent kingdoms. Kingdoms. The only thing you have to do to verify this use, as far as an illustration is concerned, you will find this in Daniel chapter 2, where the little stone became a great mountain. And later on, we have identification of that mountain being the mountain of God, and referring to the great kingdom of God upon the face of the earth. So these mountains that have various peaks and are illustrated with various colors represent certain kingdoms that mankind is confronted with, politically speaking, upon the face of the earth from the early chapters of the Bible right on through time and ending, of course, in eternity. Now, of course, you're acquainted with the cross. Relates to the death of the Lord Jesus. The crown, referring, of course, to the Lord Jesus as king, will come back and reign for 1,000 years. And then this particular line, entitled the grave, relates, of course, to the place of the departed dead as far as their bodies are concerned. And the Bible has much to say with reference to the program of God concerning the grave or the dead. Then you have another line here, and behind this word, you'll see paradise. And then this line, you'll see Hades. But this Hebrew word Sheol is an Old Testament term that embodies, as far as we can determine, embodies both the place of the blessed dead of the Old Testament, as well as the place of the wicked dead of the Old Testament. Now, this term Sheol has a number of meanings as far as the Old Testament is concerned. For instance, you have in Jonah the matter of the whale or the big fish that has swallowed Jonah. And it says in the second chapter that out of Sheol he prayed. So that, you see, the term Sheol has a number of various meanings as far as the word of the Lord is concerned. But basically speaking, Sheol can be understood as the place of the departed in the Old Testament, referring both to the place of blessing and to the place of torment. Then when you come to the New Testament, in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, as well as in the book of Acts, that is in Acts chapter 2, you find this Greek word Hades. Now that Greek word Hades is translated in our New Testament, as far as English is concerned, as hell. But it has a specific reference to the purpose of God and the program of God as you unfold the word of the Lord. And so, for practical purposes in our study, that in the Gospels and before the Lord ascends, the New Testament Greek word Hades more or less takes over the significance of the Old Testament Hebrew word Sheol. And so Hades then becomes the place of the departed. Now you will observe that this line changes. This line only goes so far, and then we find it pointing up. You'll recall that the Lord Jesus Christ, when he was crucified, body was buried, and then we're told in the second chapter of the book of Acts, as well as in 1 Peter chapter 3, that he went to Hades or hell, and he preached to the spirits in prison. Then in Ephesians chapter 4, we read, when he ascended, he led captivity captive. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, you read the Apostle Paul's testimony, I knew a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell, about 14 years ago and so forth. Such an one was caught up to paradise, the third heavens. And so we feel that in light of Ephesians 4, when the Lord Jesus Christ was raised from the grave, he ministered for 40 days upon the face of the earth. Isn't that right? Speaking to the disciples, ministering to them things concerning the kingdom of God. And then, after 40 days, in light of the last chapters of the Gospels and in Acts chapter 1, you find the Lord Jesus Christ ascending, isn't that right? And as the men stood there watching him, as he ascended into the heavenlies, then two angelic beings from heaven said, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye here gazing into heaven? This same Jesus which was taken up from you shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go." And then they were to get busy with the commission which was theirs for that purpose. And so when the Lord Jesus Christ ascended, we feel that in light of Ephesians chapter 4, that the place of blessing of the departed was transferred from Sheol or from Hades and was taken to the third heavens. And so now, after the ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that of course was just, you see, just before Pentecost, at Pentecost, the beginning of the church now, that all mankind, all wicked mankind who die, their bodies go to the grave, and then their souls and spirits go to Hades, to stay in Hades in torment until the great day of resurrection, in light of Revelation chapter 20, where it tells us both death and Hades delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to his works. And of course, you know, no one is justified by works. And on the basis then of their life, then they're cast into the Gehenna fire. Now, the term pit is properly translated and spoken of in the Bible as the abyss. Now, there's much activity that goes on as far as the abyss is concerned, or that great pit. But one of the things of significance is that when the Lord Jesus Christ descends from heaven at the end of the tribulation period, the false prophet and beast are cast into the Gehenna fire. Satan, according to the 19th chapter of the book of Revelation, is bound in the pit. Bound in the pit for 1,000 years. And then at the end of the 1,000 years, he is released or loosed for a little season, at which time he goes upon the face of the earth and brings a great rebellion against the saints and the Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, they then are destroyed. Then there is a term in our New Testament. It occurs only once. And that is in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4. And that term is called in our English Bible, hell. But it is a verse that relates to the binding of certain angelic beings. And they are bound in Tartarus, or hell, according to our English Bible, awaiting the great day of judgment. Now, we are going to look at this very interesting part of our prophetic survey in just one or two more classes. But it's most interesting, and it is by no means completely satisfactory by virtue of total agreement as to who they are. But we hope to endeavor to give you adequate biblical proof that whether we can understand it rationally or not, that we may have the mind of the Lord as to who these angelic beings are who are contained or assigned to Tartarus until the great day of judgment. Now, I would simply like to point this out to you. Hades is the place for wicked humanity. Tartarus is the place for a group of wicked angelic beings. Not all the wicked angels, mind you, because Satan has a host of wicked angels now who are cohorts with him. But this happens to be a special group of wicked angelic beings, and they are not kept in the same place of torment, awaiting their final judgment and then their eternal doom in the fire. No, they're not. God does not mix his creation in this way at all. He keeps them even separate in light of the judgment to come. Now, I believe that pretty well gives us a brief understanding of certain items that appear on the chart. And we will then follow along as best we can, and maybe not go into too great detail, but we hope to be able to cover it satisfactorily, whereby it will be of interest and it will unfold for us so that we can know with intelligence why these things have to happen. Now, one of the problems today is that people are very, very interested in events which are going to transpire immediately in the future. They are very interested in that. And there is much, much speculation as to what will happen. But listen, we may not know, and the scriptures are perfectly accurate in this way, that we do not know exactly the moment or the time. The Lord has told us that. But we can know the facts of certain events that will take place. And do you know why we can? It's because back in the Old Testament, the stage has been set for the program of God, which absolutely must and will take place. Now, this is the reason we feel as though that we should be, and in order to be honest before the Lord, that we must be very dogmatic without wavering as to what will take place, is because of what he has declared in the Old Testament and what has been verified by history. Not that we have to have history to verify it. Our Bible is perfectly authoritative in itself. But it's wonderful to see from the view of sight, or from our sight, shall we say, the facts of historians as they have recorded certain of these events, don't you see, who are just as pagan as can be in many, many cases. And they recorded historical events. But those historical events were prophesied years before that, and they're simply recording that which God said would take place. And that's going to be exactly the case later on. Now, I do not want to enter into speculation because I think that is foolish. But where the Bible speaks, let us speak. Where the Bible reveals the plan and the program of God, then let us rest in what God says. You and I may not know the various circumstances that will transpire, that will usher in some of these great, great events which are in the future. But we do know with certainty the facts of these events, and we can rest accordingly. And I'll tell you, one of the greatest things I'm looking forward to is the very next step in the plan and the program of God. You know what that is? That's what I'm going to leave. That is the wonderful rapture of the church. That's when the believers, all believers, doesn't make any difference where they are, doesn't make any difference their nationality, or ethnic group, or color of their skin, or anything like that. Every single person that's trusted in Jesus Christ as his or her personal Savior if our wonderful Lord should return tonight, and he certainly could, if he would return tonight, not to the second advent, but return in the air. Every one of us in this room, if you trusted the Lord as your Savior, you immediately would be caught up to be with the Lord in the air. Your body would be changed, fashioned unto that glorious body, just like the body of the Lord Jesus, in that glorified, wonderful, wonderful state. I tell you, it is just marvelous to anticipate this very next event. And when you see this old world with all of its godlessness as it's going on now, who wants to stick around here? No, I want to do what the Lord wants me to do. I want to be faithful to the Lord in light of his appointment upon my life. But all, listen, when God is ready to carry out his program here, I want to be standing right there in line to hear my Lord. Of course, I won't have to. He'll say, you come on. And that'll just be great. It'll be marvelous and wonderful. Well, that will pretty well take care of a bit of explanation as far as the chart. And now let's come back in our Bible and start with sort of the kickoff or the springboard for prophecy. And we'll turn to the third chapter of the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 3. And let's just simply spend the next few minutes in a very hurried presentation of some of these wonderful things which transpire in the third chapter of the book of Genesis. Ray, would you like to crack that window just a little, please? Thank you. All right, if you'll all take your Bibles, let's look at our Bibles, and I'm going to read the first 15 verses. The first 15 verses of Genesis chapter 3. And you'll observe that we have a number of personalities that are involved in this particular chapter. You have Satan involved, you have Adam and Eve involved, and you have God involved. And so let's notice this very intriguing and wonderful event. Not so wonderful, but interesting, and after all, it's the basis for the program of God. That is revealed here in these first 15 verses. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, this is the serpent, who is the devil, and all you have to do to get the classification for his name, for his title, that this is the person, Satan, is read the verse in Revelation chapter 12, old devil, the serpent, you know. And so this is Satan here. And so now Satan comes to Eve, and he begins to carry on a conversation. And his conversation is a very typical conversation in that he begins it by simply planting a little bit of doubt by virtue of a question. Yea, has God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Well, now, Satan knew that, and so did the woman. That God said, all right, you may eat of the trees of the garden, except one. Isn't that right? And so now, isn't it amazing? Right here in this third chapter, and incidentally, by application, this is exactly what he does to us. He comes along and he picks out the one thing, the very one thing that God said, no, don't do it. No, don't do it. And that's what he's going to do to you. And that's what he does to me. He comes along and picks out the very one weakest point of our spiritual life. And he zeroes in on that. And notice how he just keeps coming right back to it. Quite interesting. And the woman said unto the serpent, why, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. Now then, notice what Satan has to say with reference to the reply. I know there's been quite a lot that's been made with reference to Eve's reply, that she's added here and added there. Well, be that as it may, I think the important thing is to see what Satan does. And the serpent said unto the woman, now here's a flat contradiction. Ye shall not surely die. Ye shall not surely die. Now folks, in our pilgrim walk, when we're tempted and we're tested, do you know what Satan is doing to us? He is tempting and testing us in a way that's an absolute contradiction to God's perfect will for us. Ever so subtle it may be, but that's exactly what it is. Now then, he goes on to explain why you won't die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Now, Satan, contradicting, is also, of course, the god of lies. Because they did die. Well, they didn't die physically, but they sure died spiritually. And in that spiritual death, you know what took place? Satan was right. They had something that, oh, I'll tell you, they wish they hadn't had. And when the woman saw, and she heard him, and now she begins to toy. She begins to toy with his message. She saw that the tree, well, it was good for food, wasn't it? Yeah, you may be right. And that it was pleasant to the eye. You know, that looks real good, doesn't it? And you know, I'll bet that tastes just wonderful. Wait. And a tree to be desired, to make one wise. Let me ask you a question. Is Satan doing this to the household of faith today? I'll say he is. You check out. You just check the believer. You'll find the believers today, by and large, becoming far more enamored with intellectual pursuits than spiritual realities of the heart. You want me to prove it? I'm in Bible school education, and we got a student body this year of 16 wonderful kids. Well, you know, if any university in this province only had 16 kids that closed the doors, isn't that right? Well, they got hundreds and thousands, isn't that right? And are there any Christians there? Well, now, I'm not saying that Christians shouldn't go to university or anything like that. Why, far be it from me to say that. But I've talked to parent after parent after parent, and young person after young person, who, as believers, they scoff, absolutely scoff at the idea of biblical education. You know that? I came to Canada 21 or 22 years ago. I came as a pastor. I was invited, my wife and I and children were invited to the home of one of the members of the board of that church that I pastored, for an evening, a very lovely evening. They had a young man who was in grade 13. Brilliant boy. In fact, he was the top of his class. And after the lovely meal that we were entertained around, why this young man graciously excused himself and went back to his room for study. And so the man said, well, Dr. Clark, I'd like to show you our home. I'd love to see it. And so he showed me around the home, and we passed this young man's room where he was studying. And I called him by name. And I said, it's great to see you at the top of your class. I said, have you ever thought about going in to the Lord's service? You know, the Lord needs young men like you. His daddy, oh, Dr. Clark, we want him to be a success in life. I was fascinated. How much spiritual work did I get done with a man like that on my board? Within 5 months' time, he became my ardent enemy. They got me in a year's time. No, I'm not saying that all precious young people should go by the government. But I'm saying that every single believer that's walking upon the face of this earth, God lays no priority upon the ignorance of his word. Absolutely. You are obligated, and I am obligated to know what his love letter from heaven's glory has to say. Now it's up to us to choose our priorities. And Satan right here is starting out, and it's been a problem ever since. For the dear saints of God, why? You can be wise. Why? And then she took. And she ate. But along with it, she did something else. She said, come on over, honey. It's wonderful. And so she gave to her husband with her, and he did eat. What does it tell us in verse 7? The eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked now. Divest of the righteousness of God. And so they did what they could do. They sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings, aprons. Now then notice what a blessing this was to be so wise. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife ran to have fellowship with the Lord. Is that what your Bible says? Isn't what my Bible says at all. Oh, the saddest commentary, one of the bleakest, one of the most heartrending that I know. Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord. Isn't that shame? Where did they hide? They hid among the trees of a garden. Some time ago, the Lord just convicted me so heavily, Miss Fassius. Adam and Eve did not hide themselves out in a bleak, desolate place. But they hid from the Lord in that which was good. It was there the product of the creation of God. There the Lord had, by his wonderful hand, simply brought into existence the most beautiful and lovely place for man to dwell, to dress and to care for, so that he might commune and have fellowship with man that he created in his likeness and in his image. But man chose to disobey the word of the Lord. And as a result, he was wise over it. Very wise. But he had to hide from the presence of God. And he hid from the presence of God in that which was good. Can I illustrate again from our past? One day as we were ministering the word of the Lord in this particular place, a young couple had been invited to come to the services. And as we were closing, we closed with a hymn with reference to a challenge concerning a decision for their heart. That young couple sang with the greatest of gusto. They paraded by virtue of their singing as a testimony that, my, they were entering right in to the preciousness of that message and song, which was a message that demanded the decision of their heart before God. Now listen, we never saw that couple again. What were they doing? They were hiding from God in that which was good. There it was so obvious that the Lord was moving. They knew. And so they paraded. Made believe. Yes, they were hiding from reality. Their hearts need for God. Now then, notice the next thing in verse 9. The Lord God called unto Adam, and he said unto him, where are you? The first experience for God and the first experience for man. And instead of man being there anxiously waiting to walk in the beauty of fellowship with the Lord, he was hiding. And I imagine the very heart of God, in light of our human illustration, probably cracked with the question of a lament. Where are you? Where are you? Folks, the Lord is asking us tonight, where are we to? Where are we? I don't know your life, and it's not my prerogative to know your life. And I do not want to hurt. I'm so grateful for all of you. I love you in the bonds of the Lord. But let me ask you kindly, but straightforward from the shoulder, where are you? Are you endeavoring to hide from the presence of your Lord that which may be perfectly good, but you don't hear the voice of the Lord? You don't have his presence. You're out of step. You're not in the place of his appointment. That just convicts me so much. Then you have the lamentable reply. And Adam said, I heard your voice in the garden and I was afraid. The only person who has to be afraid of God is when you're not right. The one who's afraid of the Lord is the one who first either does not know him or is hiding someplace outside of fellowship. And he said, I was afraid because
because I was naked and I hid myself. And the Lord said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou should not eat? And now notice, his reply. Man, he just starts doing just like you and I do, making excuses, isn't that right? And passes the buck from one place to another. And he said, the woman. Yeah, the woman. And then you're to blame too, the woman whom you gave. Now, God, you shouldn't give me that woman. But the woman you gave to be with me, she's the one that gave to me of the tree. And I was just innocent. I Why, you ought to be out there sometimes when I rake over those Bible school kids. They're right square back in the third chapter of the book of Genesis. And they're Bible school kids too. Precious. And the Lord God said unto the woman, what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, well, now, you know, it was the serpent that did it. Satan did it. Now, he's the one's to blame. I just sort of innocent. He pushed me into it, you know. He gave me the revolver, and he cocked it, and he put my finger on the trigger, and then he accidentally bumped my arm, and it went off, God. Yes. And I did eat. And then the Lord God said unto the serpent, because you've done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of your life. That snake is still calling, isn't it? That snake, that serpent, that was embodied of Satan, that embodiment is still doing just what God said he would do. Now then, in verse 15, the springboard for the prophecy that you see unfolding before you on the chart. Now notice these three things. First of all, God's declaration of a conflict. I will put enmity between thee and the woman. There's God's declaration of war. Now, he says, I've declared. I will. God makes war with Satan. Now then notice the characters that are involved in this conflict between thee and the woman and between thy seed and her seed. The posterity of the seed of the serpent, the posterity of the seed of the woman. And the serpent is that which relates and stands for all of the lost. The woman's seed, of course, the Lord Jesus Christ, is the seed of the woman. And all those that are related to him by the new birth are his seed. Now listen, God says there's conflict. Now it behooves us not to try to make peace on man's terms, but on God's terms. God says, repent. Repent. Trust Christ. He may do it. We cannot join the enemy's camp. We can't do it. God's declared the war. Now that relates to the conflict and the chief characters involved. But please notice, if you will, the sure consummation of this conflict. It shall bruise thy head. Thou shalt bruise his heel. You see, in light of this declaration, right back here, the early chapters of the book of Genesis, God states that the seed of the woman would bring the death blow
the death blow to the seed of the serpent, or to the serpent. He'd vanquish him. Ah. But the seed of the serpent would bruise his heel. Yes, there will be casualties. It's a conflict. It's a turmoil. It's difficult. And it's all the way through from time to eternity. And regardless of the facets of things which we see unfolding, there is still the conflict between the right and the wrong. There's still the conflict between Satan and his group and God and his family. That's true. And you find this problem constantly, constantly, constantly. And that's the reason for the necessity of the cross right there. But oh, listen. Right back there in Genesis 3:15, I'm assured of the outcome. I'm guaranteed of absolute victory. And do you remember the 8th chapter of the book of Romans where it says, list the number of things of our trials, and he says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us and gave himself for us. Therefore I'm persuaded that neither life nor death nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor height nor depth nor things to come, things present or things to come, shall be able to separate me, separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. It's declared in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, and it unfolds with interest and accuracy as we look into the Word of the Lord. So next time, if you would read over Genesis chapter 6, as we look at one of the great, first great conflicts that come in upon the scene, Genesis chapter 6 through about Genesis chapter 10. We will deal with this chapter then more than next Monday night. Our Father, thank you for the time that has been ours to fellowship together with these dear ones of the Lord. We pray that you would minister your grace upon each heart, grant safety and care as they journey to their home tonight, and that you would protect each one of us from the evil one. Prayer so many years ago that he prayed, Father, keep them from the evil one. How thankful we are. We feel that you will be not vulnerable, only by virtue of your permissive will. So grant now your care, love, and grace to rest.